celebrating Riccardo. I am not have not been his student, but I know since I graduated, he came to Capri, and many of the people here were there, definitely Gabriele, Carlos, Sergio, Riccardo. I remember that I was telling Gabriele that they were talking about the last BMW, their work with Barbieri Masiero Veneziano. Anyway, it's an honor to speak, to be a chairman in this session. And so is, I will introduce Michelangelo to his to the first talk, A Passion for Precision.
Thank you, Giancarlo. I think that the title of this symposium reflects well the fact that Riccardo is a man of passions. Passion for physics, of course, passion for music, passion for family. And if you go through his scientific career, I think that one can single out among the various topics also possibly a passion for precision, which is something that I share with him, and therefore I think that nowadays I will try to explain is a topic of significant relevance in our field. So I thought I would dedicate this contribution to Riccardo, selecting this as a topic. For sure, precision is a theme that recurs very frequently in his work. It's in the title of at least 20 papers, more or less, and it certainly forms the body of many, many others across different topics, from QCD to, of course, electroweak physics. So I, as my title said, I will talk about precision in the LHC era, and my talk will be focused on, of course, the program at the LHC in these days. We got a problem while reading my document. Well, we had tested down to page 2. It worked, so, you know. 2 is even, 4 is even, every number is even. That was a bit... non funziona, non gira le pagine.
È il documento suo, praticamente, è un formato che è troppo pesante per...
PDF, no, non ci sono...
Non so, aspetti. Ma delicato. Provavo posso provare a chiederlo, vediamo un attimo a bilanciare. Dove l'ha salvato?
Ce l'aveva lì.
Questo?
No, ce l'aveva in questo quadro che è appena aperto.
Però è strano. No, accesso negato. Ha di nuovo la penina, se mi permette.
Okay, so I will start by reviewing what are the three key outcomes of 3 years of data taking at the LHC. I think that outcome number one is very clear, the discovery of the Higgs boson in a very clear way, and the observation that its production and decay properties match what is expected within the standard model at the level of about 20%, which is the current accuracy, and I'm sure that Gigi will give many more details about this statement. So the question that arises from this observation is how far can we push the precision of these tests? As I said, so far we can tell to within 20% that things are consistent with the standard model. How far can we go? Can we go down to 5%, 1%? How much can we can we probe not just of the Higgs properties, but more in general of a correlation between the Higgs and the electroweak symmetry breaking sector, and verify whether it does things do behave as in the standard model or not? The second key outcome of these first 3 years at the LHC is that there is absolutely no sign of beyond the standard model of physics, no matter of where the experiments have looked, and they have looked at many, many places. This table, which I guess you can hardly see from the far, collects limits extracted from the CMS experiment on models where quarks are composite, leptoquarks exist, fourth generations, contact interactions, extra dimensions, and so forth and so on. And there are analogous tables for various. You don't see the word supersymmetry here. That's because supersymmetry has its own plot with all of the different variants. Absolutely, there is nothing there. And the big question, of course, that comes out of this is, where is everybody? Namely, where are all of these particles that we know must be someplace, because we know that the standard model is not enough to describe all we see. There ought to be dark matter, there has to be something that addresses the so-called hierarchy problem. There ought to be sources of CP violation beyond what we know in the standard model to explain the baryon asymmetry of the universe. And all of this has to come from some place. There has to be a slot in the Lagrangian to describe any of the objects responsible for this. So where are they? The third outcome of these 3 years of physics at the LHC is that the accuracy of a theoretical description of high Q-square phenomena really exceeds our best possible expectations. And this is just one example. This is the cross-section for, this is the differential distribution in the invariant mass of two jets. So this is proton-proton going to two jets, as a function of a dijet invariant mass on a range that goes all the way up to 4.55 TeV. So this is 5,000 GeV of energy just in this couple of quarks or gluons coming out from the hard collision. The different curves correspond to data taken with jets with different rapidity, so more central and less central collisions. And of course, by comparing all of these, one probes also the angular distribution of the jets. And there is something that you cannot see here, which is the comparison between the data and the absolute theoretical predictions, and you don't see it because pretty much the theoretical curves go through the points. This is shown in these relative comparisons. This is the ratio between the data and the theory, and now we don't have orders of magnitude. We just have a scale which is plus or minus 50%. And the different bands corresponds to the theoretical systematics, the experimental systematics, the choice of different parton distribution functions, different compatible parametrizations of quarks and gluon densities in the proton. And as you see, within 10 or 20% throughout the full rapidity range, things agree. And this is a first principle prediction of a standard model of QCD. There is no tuning, there is no overall scale factor, so we can predict to 10% the dynamics of jets, which is really remarkable. It's not just jets, but there is a multitude of processes which is summarized in this table, including production of Ws plus jets, Z plus jets, associated production of gauge bosons, W pairs, WZ, TT-bar, TT-bar plus jets, you name it, whatever process in the standard model, the data and the theory agree very well. So the key question here is whether we can make use of these somehow unexpected, perhaps, precision in our ability to describe the properties of LHC final states, and therefore use precision as a new discovery tool for the LHC. I want to make a few remarks. First of all, as you know, the LHC has been running so far up to 8 TeV, and it will move now to 13, 14 TeV. So there is a big range for possible new discoveries. And of course, we all hope that the future of our field will be driven by easy smoking gun discoveries, namely discoveries that come with mass peaks, discoveries where there is no question as to whether there is a background or not, because they are so clear, like Higgs going to gamma-gamma. There is no question about it being a new particle. And all of the constraints on beyond the standard model physics that we obtained during the first 3 years of the LHC will be washed out very soon, because by doubling the energy, it's enough to collect a few inverse femtobars, which means a few months of data taking to really go beyond those constraints, and therefore there is room for 5 sigma discoveries of new physics by the end of 2015, by the end of the first year of data taking at the higher energy. If that doesn't happen, and you know, we have no guarantee that that will happen, beyond that is what I would call sweat and blood, because if we don't have smoking gun discoveries, it means that we really have to work very hard to convince ourselves that there is some discrepancy. In other words, if we ever see discrepancies, and we haven't seen any, even seeing a discrepancy may not be a clear and robust way to make a claim about new physics. So that means that beyond that, if there is no quick discovery in the next run of the LHC, the rest of the LHC program, we have to focus on the precision, on our ability to convince you and the rest of the world that we know what we are doing and that discrepancies from the expectations are justified to make justified claims for the existence of new physics. So there are different possible ways in which we can discuss precision in the context of BSM physics for the LHC. So I just focus here on a couple of scenarios and I put them in perspective. The first one is the one of the canonical meaning of precision physics, which is what we inherited from electroweak precision tests at LEP. So pretty much the relation between the parameters of the electroweak theory, the masses of the W boson, of the top quark, of the Higgs, of the Z, the sine squared theta W, and the data. The second is the Higgs properties, which in a sense one could also incorporate as part of the electroweak precision test, because we are exploring Higgs properties is part of the electroweak sector. And then more in general on the use of just generic final states, like for example the jet cross sections I discussed before, as a way to probe BSM signals. So you all know the way these precision electroweak tests work through radiative corrections. One cross-correlates the masses of all of the gauge bosons of the Higgs as well as the mass of a top quark, and at the end of the day, using inputs from precision measurements, one can extract relations which could be approximated in this way between the W, the top, and the Higgs boson mass. So now that we know we have direct measurements of all of these three parameters, we can just put them into a plot and verify whether they agree with the a priori prediction. This point with error bars is the experiment, represents the experimental data, and these ellipses, 1 and 2 sigma, represents the fit obtained by just fitting the overall amount of data, leaving out, of course, the Higgs mass itself. And the result, as you see, is certainly very good within a bit more, perhaps, than a sigma, even though we see that maybe, you know, you would like it better to be sitting exactly in the center here. So whether this is a first indication of some anomalies in the electroweak sector or whether it's just an indication that the theoretical calculations are not accurate enough is something that will have to be, remains as an important topic, and therefore trying to continuously improve the direct measurements of the W and the top quark will be a high priority for the program at the LHC. For example, this is another way of looking at the previous plot in which this is the standard model expectation, this is the data, and they just barely touch. And this green region is how things could change within this room if one added to the standard model, for example, supersymmetric particles, and then it's certainly much easier to find specific supersymmetric models in which there is perfect agreement with the direct measurement of the W and the top mass. Now, sorry? Yeah, of course, but I mean, thank you, yes, I understand that, right? But if one could give 5 seminars on this, which is just to make the picture clear to those who may not be familiar with these topics. Now, we've been using these tools very successfully in the past to make predictions for unseen particles, flavor physics, for example, to predict the charm, as well as the mass of the top, the electroweak physics to predict the mass of the top and the mass of the Higgs. But this was made possible because we did have a very precise reference framework. That was the standard model. So we took the data, we had the standard model, we knew that the top had to be there, that the Higgs had to be there, and therefore we made very precise predictions on these objects. Now we're done with the standard model, and we don't have such a framework. If we see a discrepancy, for example, in those plots before, it's not like we are guaranteed that there is a given particle X and we go out and set limits on that particle X, because there could be many, many possible models that explain that discrepancy. So we have no way to interpret in an unequivocal way deviations from the standard model. For example, the G-2 of a muon anomaly, which is larger than 3 sigma, if it became 5 sigma, it would not give us a mass window for a very specific new particle that we know should exist and that therefore we could go after, or anomalies in Higgs branching ratios, etc. So it's much harder to precisely guide the next steps. For example, if we get the G-2 anomaly confirmed to 5 sigma, what would be the new experiment that can guarantee a clarification of a BSM origin? That we certainly cannot do. We can answer this question in many different specific scenarios. Each of them could be pointing to a different experimental facility, and we cannot just go and study them all. So the problem is much more difficult today than it was in the past, and use of these electroweak precision data and tests somehow will have to be rethought. This is possibly a good example. This is taken from one of the early papers from Riccardo, Guido, and Francesco, in which they studied the first data coming out of LEP. It's written in a different language with different variables, but the bottom line is that there is an area which is favored by the data, and then where the standard model would be as a function of the Higgs mass and as a function of the top mass. And as you see, the fact that the Higgs had to be light, that was already clear at the time. We're talking about 1993, so just a few months before the discovery of the top quark. However, the top mass was in the range of 125 GeV. If you look at 175, which is the value of a top mass, we are significantly out. So having built a new E plus E minus facility at 250 GeV to go after the top here, of course, would have been a mistake. And of course, these things evolved, and I think that Gigi will in part cover this history, how these things evolved by better understanding the experiments and better understanding the machine, the energy scale of the beams, etc. So that's why one has to be very careful in planning future facilities based on these. Here I have a few technical points on the various masses, but I don't think. So let me come now to the properties of the Higgs. In the Hadron Collider, we can measure certainly the mass to a good accuracy, and that's already known at the level of half a GeV, which pretty much for all of the applications is good enough, today's applications. So the next important thing is the measurement of the branching ratios, and in particular relative branching ratios, ratios of branching ratios in different channels, because that's something that is more easily controllable in the Hadron Collider. And this table presents forecasts for different scenarios. Here we're talking about, say, 10 years from now, 3,000 inverse femtobarns is about 20 years from now. The two experiments, the number in brackets, are in percent, the precision with which the ratio, say, of the W and the Z branching ratio will be obtained, so at the level of 2%. And the different numbers in brackets correspond to different assumptions on the theoretical uncertainties. So if one could reduce to zero the theoretical uncertainty, one would get the smallest numbers. If one had to live with today's theoretical uncertainty, one would have numbers which could be bigger. Here, for example, the accuracy degrades by a factor of 2 if one cannot improve here even more than a factor of 2. If one cannot improve the theoretical precision. These theoretical uncertainties are driven by many elements. They're driven by our ability to calculate precisely a total cross-section or our ability to model the specific details of a final state, because the experiments don't see all of the decay products of the Higgs. They have to put some cuts, some experimental constraints. And the moment they do that, automatically they affect the extraction and the interpretation, because only a fixed fraction of all of the Higgs decays can be seen, and how many of those have fallen within the experimental acceptance is something that typically one has to rely on upon the theory to determine. So these are, for example, uncertainties, the scales here at the level of 20% on the PT spectrum of the Higgs. So if we look at the Higgs is produced in glue at PT equals to zero, at zero order, but of course initial state radiation will just boost the Higgs, and experimentally it's very important to know what's the PT spectrum, and this is theoretical uncertain yet by several twenties of percent. Understanding the PT spectrum at very high PT, for example, is not just a measurement of QCD, but could also tell us something about what really happens in the Higgs coupling to gluons. As you know, the leading diagram for the production of the Higgs from two gluons is mediated by this loop, including top quarks. But we, of course, cannot really expose what's inside this loop. Other objects could be running inside these loops and, of course, affect the production and the decay rates. If we look at high PT, we need to add an additional gluon to the final state. One way of going to high PT is to radiate a gluon from the initial state and have this glue produce the Higgs that recoils. But when the PT is larger than the top mass, then the gluon has a short wavelength and therefore can go really inside the loop and can go and look at what's inside the loop through diagrams like this. And what is interesting is, for example, that obviously here there is a T-channel exchange of a gluon, so the angular distribution of the gluon and the Higgs will be a Rutherford-like scattering, while here we have something that has no T-channel exchange. This contains certainly a scalar contribution. So going to very high PT and looking at the angular correlation between the Higgs and the jet can, for example, provide some useful information. So this is a bread and butter measurement that could tell us something about what happens inside. Experimentally, the measurement of a PT of a Higgs is something that soon will be done. Historically, you know, we really built a whole branch of QCD calculations out of a study of a PT distribution of a Z boson. As soon as it was discovered, with just 16 events, the first plots of a PT distribution of a Z will be drawn, compared against the theoretical calculations. And in the case of the Higgs, we already have about 30 events observed by both ATLAS and CMS on a background of about 30. So there is room to start plotting the PT. The absolute prediction for the Higgs cross-section is what sets the ultimate limit to the precision we can obtain, comparing how many Higgs have been produced with how many we expected to have been produced. So that's the ultimate accuracy that we can hope to obtain in extracting branching ratios and couplings. And this is therefore dominated by theory. There are two components. One is perturbation theory, the fact that we only calculate up to a given order in perturbation theory, next to leading order in most of these cases. And then there is an uncertainty that comes from the knowledge of the parton densities of the proton, how many gluons and quarks and what's their X distribution inside the proton. So for the process of inclusive Higgs production through glue, the theoretical uncertainty is at the level of plus or minus 10%, in spite of the fact that this is a next to leading order calculation. So this is not like electroweak physics where leading order, next to leading order already brings you down to the percent level, to a few percent level. And PDFs is also large. Other processes are known with much better accuracy. So these things are hard to improve because it means going beyond the precision we have, and in particular to next, to next, to next, to leading order for glue, to Higgs, which is really a very, very hard task. Theory, nevertheless, is improving very fast. Not only, you know, VLHC is an incredible piece of machinery and the experiments are wonderful detectors that took very many years to build and operate. In theory, similar big enterprises are taking place. The calculation of next to next to leading order processes in hadronic collisions has progressed significantly, starting from the first results on the Higgs in 2005. There is one previous result that was the vector boson, the W and the Z production in the mid-90s. So it took about 10 years to progress to these. And then, as you see, there is an accumulation of new results just in the last few months, on digets, on the TT-bar cross-section, on Higgs plus jet, Z plus gamma, etc. Next to leading order by now has become an industry. You can really go out, download code that every kid can just press a button, decide the initial state, proton, proton, the final state, two top on a W, you press a button, and it has the full calculation at next to leading order. Next to leading order is more of an art. It's something that requires craftsmanship. You cannot yet make it automatic, and that's why it's harder to make progress, but we're moving in that direction. And when we come to next to leading order, this is like making Stradivari violins, right? This is something that you would only entrust on very few people who dedicate years of their life to develop the necessary tools. These are very hard calculations, and nevertheless, they are coming about. Most of the calculation of the next to leading order exact result is being done, and maybe within a couple of months we will have the exact result. And there are complete approximate next to leading order results, which are the approximation derived by exploiting the structure of a leading large and small x singularities and resumming the relative logs. So this is how the scale uncertainty in the calculation improves, going from next to leading order to the next to next result. As you see, it flattens out as a function of the scale, so it will give more accurate predictions. Do I have 5 minutes? The program of improving the knowledge of the gluons and the quarks inside the proton, that also can be carried out at the LHC with dedicated measurements. For example, if you want to know the gluon density at the appropriate Q square and X values that are relevant for Higgs production, we can take a Z boson recoiling against a jet. This is mostly Compton scattering, quark gluon going to Z quark. So it's sensitive to the gluon in the initial state, and by tuning the PT of the Z and the rapidity, we can really explore and cover the full range, which is necessary. Nowadays, the uncertainty is at the level of plus or minus 5 to 10% on the prediction for the Z boson due to PDF uncertainties, and with the data, very precise data that hopefully we will get from the LHC, this can be pushed down automatically. The Higgs cross-section will benefit in precision. I move now for a couple of minutes to discuss other topics, and namely just the study of generic standard model final states. This is one example taken from the study of W pair production, where there is a standard model prediction, which is quite robust, at a level of 3 or 4% in the standard model, and there are data. And if you look at these numbers in detail, you find that there is a systematic 2-sigma deviation from the measurements and the standard model. And if you combine, because these are data from different experiments and different energies, if you combine these 2-sigma becomes larger than 3-sigma. Is that something that, you know, we should be worrying about? This is an interesting place, because a place like this is where we could be hiding chargenos, leptons, a set of supersymmetric particles that are very hard, weakly interacting, that are very hard to see in a smoking gun way, and they could really be hiding that could really be hiding in signals like these. So the question is, what do we need to do? Are we ever going to be able to, if these were to grow to 5 sigma, are we ever going to be able to use it as an indication that there is no physis? What the mechanism by which we build confidence and the right tools? And there is a whole class of measurements that have to be done and that could dramatically improve these and reduce these. You see, these measurements appear to be systematics dominated, but all of these systematics can be reduced if one were, for example, to take ratios at different energies, ratios of W pair relative to the Z pair, a process where we would not be contaminated by this background. So it does require a lot of very dedicated and specific work to address these issues. And theoretically, some of these predictions can also improve dramatically, but it requires work. And there is a whole list of many observables that have not been looked at as yet, because most of the focus, of course, went into discovering the Higgs and looking for BSM phenomena. There is also a large class of examples of processes where we could see discrepancies. We look at the JET ET distribution. I showed you it agrees with the data, but if it didn't agree, what can we conclude? Can we go straight ahead and say that the quark has to be composite? What can we measure that will convince ourselves that the discrepancy is in fact due to physics and not to our inaccurate knowledge of PDFs? So a few final remarks to conclude. I think it's clear to all of us that the real crucial point now that we are stuck with is the question of where is everybody, and that's what the program should be focused on. However, I think that even though our focus has to be on the search for new physics, I think it's unjustified. It could be very dangerous today just to go out and promise that we will be making spectacular discoveries in the next couple of years, and to tie the success of the future of our program to these imminent discoveries, because nothing guarantees that we will be making these discoveries in the next few years. So that's why I believe that it's very important to integrate the program of searches with a very complete and thorough program of precision measurements. It will help us gain a more solid understanding of standard model dynamics. It will improve inputs to the global electroweak fits. And it will allow us to directly probe what could be possibly subtle evidence of new phenomena. For that, we need to do a lot of work, both on the theory side and on the experimental side. I think that precise measurements have a scientific dignity, that they are not BSM searches. And I believe that we should give them, again, not just the precision measurements in the sense of electroweak test, but also bread and butter measurement of cross-sections, Drell-Young cross-sections, Jet cross-sections. They will play a crucial role in the future. On one side, because they are an excellent training ground for the young physicists to learn how to do experimental physics, and also because we really couldn't get stuck for a long period in which, after the Higgs, no new discoveries will be made. And the only way in which we can keep the field alive while we wait for the next big machine that will make the discoveries is by doing measurements and hopefully finding new things behind those measurements. So this is my last slide on what a possible future could be. Some of you may have heard that CERN has started now thinking about a possible next generation of machines. This is the LHC, the 27-kilometer tunnel, and this is what's being thought about, which is a 100-kilometer, 80 to 100-kilometer tunnel that could host a Hadron Collider in the range of 100 TeV, and possibly also any plus or minus, a new circularly plus or minus collider in the range of 350 GeV to be able to study with great precision the Higgs. This will happen 30, 40 years from now, and I think the big question is, can we get something like this if we don't discover anything new at the LHC? I believe we must ensure that we get something like this if we don't discover anything new, because if we don't discover anything new at the LHC, we really don't know how to proceed. Our field is dead. So we have to make sure that we can fill those 20, 30 years with physics that will keep us, our students, and the young research excited. And that is measurements of things that exist.
Thanks for the nice seminar.
Michelangelo, I totally agree with the general philosophy, to the point that I even posted a little paper 2 weeks ago precisely about these issues. If you show the list of the things that can be done after what will happen in the first X inverse femtobarn, you remember it's probably the second or the third the second or the third slide, in which you have the list, you say precision. You see what I mean? Precision test No. You have in any case, I remember it very well. You have precision tests. And then you have, that it is, right? X properties, and then inclusive. There is one obvious addition to that list, which is flavor physics, which is at least equally important. And there is a slightly less obvious, but to me, perhaps even more important, which is something that will also require patience and luminosity and so on and so forth, which is searches for extra X's. For extra X's is something that I don't think will happen in the first 20 inverse femtobarn, right? But that is in fact, it's probably the relatively single thing that could help in making us understand a possible 3 sigma deviation in one of those indirect things.
I fully agree. Flavor, I had it in a previous incarnation of this talk, but I cut it out because I didn't have time. And certainly, if you had asked me, I didn't talk about any search for new physics, right? But certainly, additional Higgs would be very high on my list. I agree.
And yes. The point is that
and Luciano
happen,
will.
It will not happen in the next.
It could come, right? But I mean, this is also Luciano. We will just focus on this topic in his talk.
There is the X properties on your list, but you didn't mention the total width measurement of the, which I think also an important issue.
I have a comment on the G-2. In a way, the way to resolve G-2 is the LHC, because the discrepancy in the G-2 is very big. It's 30 times 10 to the minus 10. In some units, it's 30. And the electro weak is 15. So it's a very big correction. And that makes it, on one side, that makes you suspicious that this is, in fact, not correct. On the other hand, if it is really due to new particles, as it should be, then they should be around the corner. Because, so I think that LHC is the way to solve the to give an answer to the and if the, in the next years no new particle will be found, that will detract a lot from G-2, but it would be good to make another experiment. Is there another experiment on G-2 planned?
At Fermilab, yes.
Two.
Well, the one at Fermilab is going to happen, so, because they're already installing.
This is very important. Yeah.
Yes, with both challenges, yes.
any more questions? Okay. The next. Yeah.